What a beautiful prelude. Thank you so much, Ruth. Indeed. Fairest Lord Jesus. What a wonderful way to begin our Labor Day weekend sermon. I'm not going to start the sermon right now, okay? I'm going to wait a little bit later. Let me get my thoughts together and welcome you to worship as we gather in one of our three services here, and we welcome others who are joining us online. We're so glad that you're here. I know we have some guests with us today, especially on a holiday weekend like this, and we extend a special welcome to you. We're glad you're here to worship with us today. And so I'm going to let you look at the Weekly Ringer. A lot of things. Obviously, we come to September today. Next week, the choir is going to be back, and we're looking forward to that so much. And so things will begin to pick up very, very quickly as we come back. Obviously, the offices will be closed tomorrow on Labor Day, and then Tuesday morning, things will pick up. And all through the next few months, we've got a lot of things coming up, so please pay attention to the Weekly Ringer and all the things that are coming up in terms of fellowship and mission and committee work, all the many things that make Christ of the Hills United Methodist Church a church that brings in and builds up and reaches out. And so we welcome you again today, and I'm going to invite you now to stand and join me in the responsive call to worship followed by our opening hymn. This comes from the 90th Psalm. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love.
Let your work be manifest to your servants, and your glorious power to their children.
Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us.
And prosper for us the work of our hands. Oh, prosper the work of our hands.
And we're going to sing hymn number 152. Let's join together. All right, using the Apostles' Creed, let's join together in the affirmation of our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
Flowers on the altar are given to the glory of God by Dean and Bev Patton in celebration of their 19th wedding anniversary, and by Ken and Betsy Ellis in celebration of their 53rd wedding anniversary. And the flowers in the Welcome Center are given to the glory of God by Bill and Shay Baker in celebration of their 59th wedding anniversary. Yeah, we'll give God praise. It's all right. And if my math serves me right, cumulative, that's 131 years of marriage. That's not bad. That's pretty good. They do that at annual conference. They put all the retirees and they add up all the, and that's say how many. So I just thought I'd add that in there. It didn't go over real well, but that's all right. It's all right. We extend our prayers to those who are on our prayer list. Couple that we want to add here is in the hospital at St. Vincent in Hot Springs is Donna Miller, and at a Houston hospital is Stacy Simonton's brother Robert. He's in critical condition. You want to keep him in our prayers as well. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Almighty and gracious God, we thank you so much. We thank you for this church, but Father, we thank you for the fuel behind that church, and that is your Holy Spirit. It is at work here. It is at work in our committees. It's work in our ministries. It is work as we share a sermon or the message of the songs or those even written so many years ago that Spirit moves through that message. Father, we have work to do. That work is we are to be the church. Not only do we need to share your message of salvation, share your message of grace and love, but we need to armor up. We need to suit up. So, Father, as you provide these materials, help us to suit up every day and go to work, to place the belt of truth around our waist, the breastplate of righteousness upon our chest, the helmet of salvation upon our head, to put and pick up the shield of faith, to extinguish everything that Satan throws at us, and your sword, your living word in the other hand. And helping us to wield it to the best of our ability. But Father, give us the footing. Give us all that we need to stand our ground. And when the day is over, we're still standing for you. Put us to work, O God. But start us out by suiting us up. Ah, Father, we lift up these names that are here on the list. Ask for your healing touch to be upon them. But Father, let us not forget our own prayers. Touch each and every one here in their concerns, that they may continue to work for you. Be with Sig as he preaches today. Be with Denny as he shares his message and song. And Father God, we just say thank you for your love for us, that we may love others. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? I want to introduce to you, in this corner of the good and the right, stands a champion robed in white. His hide seeks the heaven, his weight outweighs the world. He reaches everywhere, his age is evermore. He is higher than the highest, greater than the great. No one will ever take his crown away. He is more mighty than the mightiest, he reigns from above. He's the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion of love. He left his hometown to enter this arena, to raise his hands in victory for you. But an angry crowd crucified this king who wore the crown, as they gladly watched the champion going down. But I will never count him out, for I'm a witness of the day he rose to reclaim the title, the champion of love. He is higher than the highest, greater than the great. No one will ever take his crown away. He is more mighty than the mightiest, he reigns from above. He is higher than the highest, greater than the great. No one will ever take his crown away. He is more mighty than the mightiest, he reigns from above. He's the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion. The all-time undisputed, undefeated champion. The all-time undisputed, undefeated champion of love, of love.
Thank you so much, Denny. What a powerful message and song. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from Psalm 90, and I'll be reading verses 14 through 17. Hear these words from scripture. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, so that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad as many days as you have afflicted us, and as many years as we have seen evil. Let your work be manifest to your servants, and your glorious power to their children. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us, and prosper for us the work of our hands. O prosper the work of our hands. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Please bow with me. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come before you today reminded of the boundless love of Jesus that sustains us and calls us to be your hands and feet in the world. As we present our gifts, tithes, and offerings, we do so with hearts full of gratitude for the sacrifice of your Son, who gave everything for us. May these gifts be used to spread your love, feed the hungry, comfort the brokenhearted, and bring hope to those in need. Transform our offerings into acts of mercy and justice that reflect the compassion of Christ in our community and beyond. Bless these gifts and bless us as we continue to serve in your name. May we give generously, live faithfully, and love deeply, just as Jesus has taught us. For it's in his holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. All right, let's look at the order of worship here and the two passages I've given you. Reverend Sheila read a moment ago from Psalm 90. I'm actually taking this passage, the first passage, from Genesis chapter 2. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. And then from Paul's words in Ephesians chapter 2, this from the King James Bible, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." Earlier in the service, you caught my little snafu when I said, "Welcome to our Labor Day sermon," right? I think maybe the reason for that is I don't think in 50 years of ministry I've ever written a Labor Day sermon. Not that I haven't preached on Labor Day weekend, I just haven't dealt with that topic of Labor Day. So this is a first for me, and can you tell I'm a little nervous about it? 9 to 5, a Labor Day message. And as you see in the order of worship today, I wanted to highlight the word work in the bulletin. In our call to worship and Reverend Sheila's reading from Psalm 90, the same passage, "Oh, prosper for us the work of our hands." In the Genesis summary that I've just given you here of the 6 days of God's creating, followed by a seventh day of rest, you have 3 times God finished the work. God rested from the work. He rested from the work. So the Shabbat, the Sabbath, the day of rest, is given to us in the context of having rested from work accomplished. And then Paul's letter to the Christians in Ephesus, that we ourselves are part of God's workmanship. And created in the image of God, we ourselves have the capacity to work and to perform good works, and as many Americans will do tomorrow, to rest after the work is done. So in the bulletin, I've highlighted the word work in all caps and with a splash of red, because I wanted that word to permeate our thinking this morning. And by now you're probably chanting, "Work, work, 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 work." I thought to put in the bulletin, look at these images in the bulletin, please. And I thought to put on the top image Walt Disney's 1937 Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. That was the moment the Seven Dwarfs were introduced to America, and of course we were introduced to them with them singing, "Hi-ho, hi-ho, it's off to work we go." But I did Disney last week, right? If you were here last week, we did the Mary Poppins thing. So I chose instead an image, and for my title, 9 to 5, Dolly Parton's 1980 mega hit, 9 to 5. And I've given you the cover here of her album, 9 to 5 and Odd Jobs. And there you see Dolly doing her, "Hi-ho, I'm off to work, she goes," in high heels, no less, with tools for the various jobs. You see a painter, a gardener, a secretary, a carpenter, etc., etc. When we're talking about work in our lives, there's a lot of et cetera, et ceteras, right? The list of tasks goes on and on and on, as anyone with a job description ending with that wonderful catch-all phrase, "and other duties as assigned," no, it goes on and on and on. Have you ever felt like that about work? That it just goes on and on. I pondered this. In 1980, that's 44 years ago, I was 26 years old, living in El Dorado, and about to go to seminary. I was pastoring a church, but about to go to seminary in Memphis to really jumpstart a career. And I was thinking of all the days since 1980, over 44 years. I didn't figure it out. I should have taken my calculator and looked it up. Steve can add weddings years of anniversaries. I may do that before the next service. Where were you in 1980? Do a bit of calculation for a minute. How old were you? I want you to think about that in 1980. Ready? On the count of three, yell it out. One, two. I heard that. And where were you living? I was living in El Dorado. I won't ask you to yell it out. You just think about it. Where were you living in 1980? And upon what were you embarking? And in all these days since 1980, 9 to 5, how many of those days were filled with so many different tasks? Things you created, things you served, the ways in which you worked, the ways in which you were a blessing to others. So it gives rise to the question, when you add all those days, all those et cetera, et cetera, et ceteras of our task, is work a blessing or is work a curse? I offer a new beatitude today. Happy are those for whom work is a blessing. I have been so blessed, and for a simple reason. I love what I do. And when one loves what they do, they can engage everyday tasks, even the more unpleasant task of what they do, even the more unexpected task in what they do, even the untimely task in what they do, with a certain energy and passion and sense of satisfaction and fulfillment. I feel sad for those for whom work is more of a curse than a blessing. When task becomes filled with more weariness than satisfaction, more boredom than fulfillment, even sometimes a spirit of anger and frustration rather than a spirit of vision and mission. But I surely understand it. And as a pastor over the many years, I've counseled with many people whose work makes them feel trapped. Maybe you're one of them. Make you feel trapped. Rather than feeling sent to do their work in a hi-ho, it's off to work we go kind of excitement, they instead may feel forced, coerced, trapped into something that's not satisfying. I feel a Hebrew 101 lesson coming on. Do you? I can imagine you're thinking right now, well, since you've got me trapped in this pew, I guess you can go ahead with that. The primary Hebrew word for work used here in Genesis chapter 2, the text we looked at, is melacha. Melacha. It's used about 160 times in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. And most of those times, by far, about 140 times, it's translated simply with the word work. Other times, other words it's translated with over those last 20 or so, labor, occupation, business, but most of them, the word craft. Isn't that interesting? Craft. In other words, our work should be creating something. The creative aspect of work is obvious in the passage we read, right? God created for 6 days and then rested. And that carries over in the Hebrew description of our own labor, that we are crafting something. We are creating something. All of work is to create something. We are sent to create something. But there's another thing about that word melacha. I want you to listen to it very carefully. It sounds like an Old Testament book. Let me say it again. Melacha. What does it sound like? Malachi. Of course, the last book of the Old Testament is Malachi. His name meant my messenger, my ambassador, my sent one. Malachi means my sent one. And it's interesting that the feminine form of malach, malach means messenger, sent, ambassador. And the feminine form of malach is our word, melacha, which means work, the feminine form. Now, calm down. Don't get excited, men. That doesn't mean women are supposed to do all the work while you rest and relax, right? Just a quirk of language where many languages have all their nouns have a gender attached to them. And melacha does mean, in the feminine, means work. It is the idea that work fulfills a divine component of our lives in creating something, in being sent to create, going back to Genesis and the image of God who worked, not merely from a sense of duty, I have to do this, but from a passion to create out of God's own will. And as Paul taught, we are part of that will of God. We are God's workmanship, created unto Christ Jesus unto good works, by which I think like God, our work should be to create something as one who is malach, sent. I want you to look at that bottom image. It's a very small image there. It's just a Labor Day thank you. Thank you for your hard work. And you see there a painter, someone in the military, a policeman, a doctor, a fireman, a chef, a teacher, a nurse. Each one creates something. It may be a creation of beauty. It may be a creation of functionality. It may be a creation of health. It may be a creation of hope. It may be creating a sense of safety in someone, or of joy. Or this chef may just be creating wonderful works, or delicious, good-tasting works. Or a teacher may be imparting and creating knowledge. But every one of these creating something that contributes to the community. I look at these again, a second time, and no doubt some of them may feel trapped. I got into this, excited about it, but I'm not anymore. You think? I feel trapped, unfulfilled. And perhaps they might feel less trapped if they focus not on the 9-to-5 hi-ho, hi-ho, hi-ho reality of everyday life, but rather remember that they are melacha, sent to create something that in another's life will be important. Whatever is or was your life work, I know we're in a demographic where the majority of you are retired. Whatever is or was your life's work, and even now, maybe not working for a paycheck, but working in missions and volunteering, you are working to craft something. You are working to create something for somebody, which is the source of work becoming satisfying and fulfilling, and a gift, not only to those others for whom we are working, but a gift to ourselves. I don't mean a paycheck, as important as that may be and surely is, but I mean a gift to ourselves in the sense of purpose, a sense of calling, a sense of sentness to do something, a sense of meaning and personal value to others around us in the community. Melacha, sent to create, not just for others, but also for yourself. Now, that Hebrew lesson wasn't so bad, was it? Good, I'm glad you think so, because I'm going to finish with one more. And this is when I get to be nitpicky. I'm going to offer this in a spirit of nitpickiness. You ready? A little later in the same chapter, Genesis chapter 2, I'm going to quote from the New International Version here, verse 15 of Genesis chapter 2. The Lord now has created the man and the woman. And this is Genesis 2:15. The Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. That's the NIV. My first Hebrew professor in Memphis, when I was 27 years old, just leaving El Dorado to go to Memphis, my first Hebrew professor was on the NIV committee that translated the book of Genesis, Larry Walker, and he got this one absolutely wrong. The word work does not belong there. It's not the same word. This is not melacha. So the English translations are all over the map. The King James Version says he put the man there to dress it. The NRSV, your pew Bible, to till it. Others say to cultivate it, to care for it. The word is actually a derivative of the Hebrew word avad, which means to serve. But how does one serve a garden? That question led to translations all over the map, to work, to dress, to till, to care, to cultivate, others. I found only one translation that translated it properly, and that's the Young's literal translation, putting the man in the garden to serve it and to keep it. Serve it. That's the word. But how does one serve a garden? An inanimate object. Well, if you have a garden, you likely know, right? You may even find yourself talking to your plants and your flowers and your vegetables as if we are serving them. The garden, giving water when that water is needed, pruning when that pruning is needed, giving attention when that attention is needed. You're serving a garden. And it's interesting, in the Hebrew context and in the Hebrew spirit, many of the Psalms speak as our first hymn. That's why I picked our first hymn, I Sing the Almighty Power of God, speak of creation itself giving praise. It animates creation as the sun and the moon and the stars and the plants and all of creation gives praise to God. It speaks of it in a personal way. It personalizes all those inanimate objects. And that's what's happening here. The man was placed in the garden to serve it. To serve it. Is not all of our labor on this Labor Day a serving of others? When we understand our work as being sent to serve, and those are the two Hebrew words we've dealt with from Genesis chapter 2, sent, malacha, and serve, avad, work becomes holy. When we realize that there is a sentness in God's providence in drawing us, giving us gifts and using those gifts, there is a holiness about work. The Apostle Paul said, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as if you are working for the Lord and not for human masters. So work can become holy. And now as we move toward Holy Communion, this holy table, your worship team, and those of you who are coming to serve, we are sent to serve. And in the same way that we come behind this table and we are sent to serve, is how we should engage all the tasks that God has called us to know that God is blessing it because there is a sentness to it in order to serve others. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We remember as we come to this table how Jesus gathered with his disciples on the night that he was arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the upper room, and he shared the Passover Seder meal with them. And as he came to that table, he veered away from the ritual so that he might make it very personal, so that he might take the bread, and when he blesses it and breaks it, he gives it to the disciples, says, take and eat, for this is my body. And when he takes the cup to bless it, he gives it to the disciples and says, "Take and drink, for this is my blood, given for you and to others for the forgiveness of your sins." And so, our Father, as we gather around this table, we are invited here to participate in the redemptive act of Jesus Christ our Lord, in receiving the bread and the wine, the body and blood of Christ, to experience your presence, your real presence in our lives. And so we approach this table knowing our unworthiness. We approach this table, though, in response to your welcome, despite our unworthiness. So as we come, we seek blessing so that we might be a blessing to others, sent to do the work to which you send us. Amen. Let me invite our servers and ushers now to come, and as they come, I'll remind you that we'll be receiving Holy Communion through intinction. By intinction, I mean that you'll be given a wafer, and you'll just dip that into the chalice. Don't plunge it. Just dip it into the chalice, and then receive Holy Communion in that way. Ushers will direct you, and you can see the flow of those coming to our four stations, two in the front and two in the back. If you prefer not to take the wafer and dip it, we have the individual packets of communion that are sanitized, and it has both the wafer and the juice in it. You can just come for a blessing and then go back to your pew and receive it there. And of course, if there are those who can't move, you don't feel mobile enough, we'll bring it to you at the end of our communion, okay? Are there any to whom we need to bring the elements this morning? Okay. Join me in thanksgiving. Our God, we praise you. We thank you for the opportunity we have to gather as a community in celebration of the redemption through Jesus Christ and his suffering, his dying for us, but also his resurrection to life, a life which lives in our hearts and sends us into the world to do good works as your workmanship. Thank you. We praise you and pray for the gift of being sent to be a blessing. Amen. Amen. All right. Our closing hymn is number 159, Lift High the Cross. I ask you to turn there now, and let's stand together as we sing.
Christ's throne name, till
Amen. Thank you for joining us for worship this morning. And please now join us in the fellowship hall for a time of communion and fellowship together over coffee and cookies. My benediction today is actually printed in your order of worship. It's the middle image. I don't think I've ever done that before, but this is a Labor Day blessing. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Have a blessed and safe Labor Day. Amen.
Amen. Now let us join hands as we sing the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father.